That's going to be the agenda. So I was hoping, you know, someone from the audience will know a little bit of Japanese and help me interpret it. But I'll tell you why, you know. So the reason I put a little bit of Japanese because, and I'm going to elaborate. Okay, before some quiz. So I wanted to draw a connection. So, you know, from Japan, ultimately, you know, what do we know mainly? I mean, you know, what Japan has to, you know, do with software. Lean, and at the lean is Toyota. Small quiz, do you guys know what that Toyota logo means? So, you know, this logo was done at, you know, to commemorate 50th year of Toyota, and it almost took them 5 years to develop. It has three ovals. The first one and second one, you see one represents the company, one represents the customer, and there's a cross section which, you know, represents that, you know, they have a close bonding. And the final oval represents that, you know, the world around them. One of the other interesting that you will see is it's also, you know, the first two ovals put together, they actually represents a driving wheel, which is a pretty subtle, you know, thing in there. Also, you can actually draw Toyota from this. So, okay. So since we are, sure. Right, I will upload. Sure. Absolutely, absolutely. In fact, I actually put you know, the actual English word for each, but then I removed it. So I was hoping, because you know, there were a couple of Japanese delegates also. So I was hoping we'll try and pick some of those from them. But yeah, I'm going a little more lean and changing the course. Okay. So since we talk about lean, so at the core of lean is the customer value. So I'm going to put out, you know, what value are you going to get, you know, in the next 30 to 40 minutes. What I wanted to draw is not just come up with a ready-made lean software development principles, you know, which, I mean, if some of you have read the work of Mary and, you know, Tom and, you know, a lot of other guys, they've already distilled a lot of those lean and, you know, manufacturing concepts and put it, what can you use in software? But my objective would be to go deeper into each of these, you know, manufacturing concepts, also give a little bit of more concept, you know, or sort of history to how some of these things evolved, because that is what, you know, actually I got curious, you know, about, and you know, I dig more deeper into that. So why TPS? So this is a diagram, you know, during the course of, you know, reading some of the stuff I came across, and that sort of got me curious. If you look at all the things that we talk about today, you know, Scrum, you know, Agile, you know, Lean Software Development, Kanban, I mean, ultimately everything is pointing to Toyota still, you know, and it's been almost like, you know, 50 years, 60 years, and we are still trying to understand what they did and what made them successful. You know, and people pick up at some point of time, recent being the lean startup, a lot of those concepts which you actually apply in lean startup are coming from Toyota and, you know, lean manufacturing. So that's where I thought, you know, instead of doing something, you know, on how to do Agile and why, you know, we'll dig deeper into, you know, why some of these things evolve. I also used something which triggered me. It's called Golden Circle. It's by a guy called Simon Sinek, which says that, you know, it doesn't matter what we do, it matters why we do something, you know, why we do what we do. So ultimately, if you look at today, you know, we're doing Agile, we're doing Scrum. A lot of times we get into a, you know, sort of, you know, social proof that, you know, if X company is doing, they're seeing some benefit, let me do it. But that's not the point. I mean, the point is that, are you facing a problem? What is the problem that you're trying to solve? If you have a problem, you know, that is that, you know, you should look around, you know, the solution for, not just, you know, doing Agile and Scrum because someone else is doing and, you know, therefore you benefit. So that is what got me triggered, you know, into digging, you know, deeper into Toyota, and I'll present what you know, we have. So if you look at it's a huge history. I mean, you know, it's like 75 years of what they did and why they did, and it's not evolved, you know, unlike, you know, let's say Agile Manifesto, which actually people got together in a, you know, room for 3 days in a retreat and came up with a manifesto. Toyota history is something that they put together in almost like 50 years. You know, so they did not build each of these techniques on one day. They, you know, kept on doing at the ground level, at the, you know, at the workplace, found something, is it working, made changes, then, you know, then established as one of the process. So it's got huge legacy. And if you go deeper, then you'll figure out why some of these, you know, these things will work. So I'm going to take some of these concepts today. I mean, not all, but some of them. Anyone knows who said this? Since we are going to talk about automobile, Henry Ford. It's actually attributed to Henry Ford, though there's no evidence that he said it. But since we're talking about Henry Ford, I thought that is where we bring. Anyone knows, who built automobile? What was the first automobile in the world? It was by Daimler, a four-wheel thing, and at the same time, Benz came up with three-wheel drive. So one of the things that Ford did, I mean, they did not invent an automobile, but they actually, this is called Ford Model T, which was the most popular, Ford model. He standardized it to the extent that he could mass produce automobile. That is what changed the course of automobile industry. Till that point of time, Toyota was nowhere. They were no in the picture. Ford was selling, like hotcakes. They were able to reduce the price more and more, except, they had only black color, at that point. I'm going to introduce one more guy. So we'll go a little bit now in Japan at that point of time, what was happening. So this, anyone knows this gentleman? So he's the founder of Toyota, Sakiji Toyota. And any guess, what did he invent? So he was called the king of Japanese inventor. He had almost like 45 patents across, 8 countries in his name. And what did he, any guess, anyone knows? Textile. So it was not cars. Toyota is actually known to build automatic looms. And one of the breakthrough innovation that he did was he built, a loom and textile manufacturing was a very manual process. They used to have a machine and anything thread broke in the thing, and then the whole cloth and the yarn becomes totally waste. So he built a mechanism by which you can automatically stop the whole loom the moment a thread breaks. That actually led it was a huge change because one person could actually monitor 30 looms at that point of time. So that was a big breakthrough. So one more quick quiz. Anyone knows, so if the founder was Toyoda, why did they come up with the Toyota name? So in 1938, they ran a, when they started with automobile, they ran a public contest, so crowdsourcing was there almost like 100 years back, 50 years back. So a Toyota is, in Japanese, is through, visual brushing art, it is more luckier. It's considered to be a more luckier letter than, doing it with A. So that's why they came up and changed the whole name as Toyota. So this is where I'll come with the first concept of lean. So one of the first breakthrough invention, which was the, in automatic loom, if you see, is he came up with a thing that if I have to monitor a loom all the time, it's a waste of human, human time. So let machines do the job that machine, are supposed to do, and let human do, what I'm good at. And therefore, he invented this concept called Jidoka, which means that we should not just build automation. Automation typically means that, something can just operate on its own. It means self, he said it is autonomation, which is self-working. So let's build more intelligence into the machine so that they can do our job rather than we sitting, on that. And we'll see how this can be applied in software and how, it is actually being applied by at many places. But it has roots right there. So typical flow that they used to think is, the moment you have you found an error, you get a defect somewhere in the system, you try and, stop the line, you just stop the work, whatever is happening, notify, build some notification mechanism so that you know that there is an error, fix that problem, identify the root cause, obviously, and fix the problem, and then improve and figure out, put, mechanism in place so that next time that does not happen, right? And we'll see a couple of software examples how you can actually do it in software. So the second thing, part of the Jidoka is once you have identified a problem, you stop the line, which is they call this and-on. So if you, have you guys seen a car manufacturing unit? It's a are you from automobile industry? So it's like an assembly line. It's a moving assembly line. And there is a rod, a cord going on all across. At any point of time, if a worker, at any of the, let's say division, if he finds an error, he can stop the whole assembly line, which means that stop work stops, right? So That is what, and you know, that is what they do. So because they are so particular about not introducing a defect right at the source, that they say, you know, it is better to stop the whole production than actually let it go and we'll fix it later, you know, thing. So, and then they build visual indicators which tell everyone what is going wrong, where are the problems, so that they can go and, you know, fix you know, some of these problems. So that, let me just draw an analogy. So, you know, what do we learn from some of these techniques? Can they be applied to us? Because we also have quality problems. They also, just to, you know, make sure that they build better quality, they applied, you know, some of these concepts. So something, you know, similar can also be applied in software, because we have huge issues with, you know, bugs. I mean, just to tell you, I was just trying to get some stats on bugs. You know, the software bugs itself costed us around $60 billion each year. I mean, that was the statistics of 2002, when the software was not that popular. You know, I couldn't find a recent study, but we can imagine how much, you know, it is costing us now. The other issue is, if you, you know, we can always, we have mechanism to find the bugs, but we fix it later. But the later you fix the bug in a development process, the more expensive it becomes. So that is what they know, you know, they knew much better, because that is where they, you know, said that the bugs have to be fixed at the source. The whole quality has to be built in at the source. So I'll just bring back. So how can we apply this in software? So there are a whole bunch of mechanisms, and, you know, some of you have already, you know, gone through some of the workshop. So the best way is obviously pair programming, you know, which comes from XP. But that is a, you know, clear way to try and build quality right at the code level, because, you know, you don't want, you know, the bugs to be passed on, you know, before, you know, you can just find out the whole logical error right there before it goes to someone else. Because if two guys are working on the same thing, you know, then they have better chances to make sure that things work. The other is, you know, continuous deployment, you know, continuous integration. Test automation. There are a whole bunch of techniques. So I'm not going to go in all of these techniques, but I'm just giving you a pointer to, you know, some of these places, because this is where, you know, all these roots are coming from TPS. So all these concepts which we, as of now, use in software, you know, and take it for granted, you know, some of those have that roots right there. And some of these techniques you can apply even, you know, without being agile, lean, or, you know, any of those processes. So if you just decide that, you know, today if I'll start building quality into my software, you can pick up any of these techniques and learn and implement it without doing, you know, going the whole nine yard about, you know, agile software development. I just added, I'm a big Dilbert fan, so, you know, this is what they have to say about, you know, automation. I'll just leave it for a minute just in case. Do you guys like Dilbert? Anyone? So this might be happening to some of you. Do you get it? Your boss says, you build a tool, I am not going to pay for an automation software. Definitely, there are a lot of examples. So this is I'm giving you now software examples. People are already using it. So there's a company called Target Process. They have built a pretty robust and-on board. You know, they call it Visual Dashboard, but actually it's an and-on board, which gives them on a daily basis the quality of their build, where is it failing, how many bugs are failing, in which stage did it fail. And they just look at this whole thing, and they come to know, you know, that something is wrong, let's go and fix the problem right there. There's one more example. So there's a company called, you know, I mean, it's not a company, it's a open source stuff. It's called Lava Lamp. So some guys have built it. You know, if your build has gone well in the morning, you will see a lava lamp going green. If a build has failed, you'll start seeing red. The later you delay fixing the build, you know, and making sure that there are no errors, the lava will keep on heating up, and, you know, you will see all red there. I got even one more interesting examples. So look at this, what these guys have done. So they built a tool in Jenkins, you know, built some Python code. So it tells them the build has failed. I'll let you see that. It started, it stopped, okay. Right, so they've you know, almost like configured a gun so that it goes and, you know, shoots a sponge ball to that guy who broke the build. So they built that whole automation into that, you know, system is gonna figure out the build has failed, they will find out, you know, who broke the build, and, you know, point that, you know, to him, so that you can quickly go and, you know, sort of fix that problem. So just giving you a context of how Jidoka and on can be applied. You know, and these are all independent tools, you know, that need not be, you know, depending upon any of these, you know, big methodologies to, you know, for you to implement. The next thing that Toyota believed, and that's one of the key things for their success, is you know, Genchi Genbutsu, which they ultimately say that if you have a problem, rather than talking in a conference room, you go at the workplace and then see for yourself how, you know, some of these things are, you know, going wrong and why. Probably once you go there, you spot much more, you know, wrong, you know, what could be wrong there than, you know, actually talking about in a meeting room. So I'm going to quote one more example, which is again. So now once you find a, you know, found a problem, how do you, you know, you've just found a trigger. I mean, you've found that something is wrong. But what they believe is a lot of times, you know, that could be a superficial problem that you're trying to solve, right? I mean, for us, you know, if a, you know, they say if you have to go to the root cause, you have to apply a 5-wave technique. Which is very, very popular, and you know, I think it's a very powerful technique. I mean, you should try it. We try it at our company. If a problem comes up, you ask 5 why, just like a little kid, and it will take you to a much deeper problem, you know, which could actually end up being, you know, much simply to, you know, simpler to solve rather than, you know, you trying and doing it. And it's a tough thing. So for example, you know, your car is not starting because the battery is dead. You know, or why is battery dead? Because, you know, something else is not working. Why something else is not working? Because something else was not done at the right time. And why was not done? Because, you know, something else was a problem. So ultimately you read down and say, you know what, I mean, for example, in this case, just because you don't do your maintenance of the car in a proper, you know, time, you end up getting held up somewhere else. So in software, this also is, you know, could be easily applied. I mean, we have our servers crashing most of the time. The moment server crashes, our first response is, let's just bring it back. But a lot of times, after that response, we're just done. I mean, we brought it back, you know, done. We might just do one level of analysis and say, you know what, this was a problem with the service provider. So we'll leave it at that. But we have to go deeper. We have to figure out why is there a problem with the service provider. A lot of time, you'll find out that at the end of, you know, each of these problems, there could be some human problem. Probably there is some guy who's not trained, you know, properly, and hence, you know, he's not able to do some of these jobs, which can be easily fixed. You can just give him a, you know, 6-hour training and, you know, finish it off. So this becomes a pretty powerful technique to, you know, for you to use in anywhere. You know, it could be software, it could be, you know, any other domain. Right.
The whole team. Depth level.
The whole team. Whole team. It is collaborative. It is. You have to go. So just apply the previous principle. You have to go to the source, ask the whole team, you know, what went wrong. The only thing we have to avoid is, you know, and there could be, is this. This is what we do most of the time. So we are trying to find out who did that. I mean, does not even have to come up, you know, most of the time. You just have to figure out, you know, why is something, you know, failing. And if you're able to figure out a root cause, you know, so that is a big encouragement at Toyota. I mean, if you look at it, they have a zero defect, you know, sort of tolerance, you know, built in. But at the same time, I mean, if you go back to the culture, they have a lifetime employment. They don't fire people just like that. So people have that security that, you know what, I mean, just because of an error, I'm not going to get fired. But then that's why they also come up with the, you know, things that, okay, you know, if there is a problem, let's just fix it. So if you, you know, so a typical saving at, you know, saying at Toyota goes that if you find a problem once, that's okay. If you find it twice, you know, you're not doing your job, you know, right. Someone is not doing his job rightly, and, you know, some job is missing, some process is, you know, getting broken. So let's go and fix it. Any question? Have you guys tried 5-Eyes? I mean, anyone? Oh, okay. Yeah. So do you see a benefit? I mean, anything that you can share? Any critical problem that you solved? You can. Right.
For this is, I think company uses.
Okay, so it has been, you know. So I think that's a trend. I've seen 2-3 other companies, like, you know, the company I work with is Honeywell. They also do it pretty well. So I think somewhere the guys who have a manufacturing connection, it's so becomes natural for them to adopt. So for example, Huawei is one example. Any other? Sure. So see, some of this context, it makes sense. I mean, you know, you could even, you have to do 5-why analysis, but the outcome, you may not act immediately. I mean, you could always say that there is a you know, some percent of chance that can happen, but you can always, you know, keep it under a, you know, closer options. For example, what we do is, I mean, we also track it, you know, in just Excel sheets in shared in Google Docs. But we say, you know, if one or two, you know, one-off incidences happen, that's okay. But we have gone till the level to find out what could be suspect. So, you know, then you can build at least some more mechanism to track. For example, if we debug a code, a lot of time we don't find the bug. You know, the customers reported we don't find the bug. So what do? I mean, we have spent almost like 2 days to debug. So what do? So at least we can build in more, you know, procedures in the system to at least find something more. Put more loggers. You know, for example, it could just be one. Put more loggers so at least next time that error comes somewhere closer, you are able to find it much faster and then, you know, go and fix it.
Let's say you might have started from some superficial.
Right. So the server example that I was giving is clear. I mean, you know, so one of the things which was happening is, I mean, our servers are going down. I mean, first time it went down, a production server, we all alarmed and, you know, we're getting it. Second time, so what we figured out is there was some Windows service which was, you know, suddenly ran, which was unscheduled, and it broke the whole, you know, I mean, suddenly it restarted the whole server, and we didn't get to know. So we went, you know, deeper into it and said, you know, why, I mean, was it not checked? So there was some, you know, there was no checklist for someone to check because the ITS guys were new. We said, why is there no checklist? So because, say, you know, we don't have as many servers to monitor. I mean, that was one of those cases because, and this guy is a relatively newer guy. So then we put you know, whole process, some of these, you know, cheaper processes in place so that you have a checklist if you're making a new, you know, building a new server, you have a place. We put some loggers so that if it going down, I mean, going down was one thing. I mean, without all of us not knowing about it was another thing. I mean, you know, why do it, you know, had to be reported by someone else, you know, for you to know that this has gone down. So you could always put, you know, more you know, things in place so that you know, get notified quickly. All right. So one more technique that Toyota, you know, at Toyota that they use very frequently is Pukkayoke. It's called mistake proofing. So if you know it's a problem which is happening at some of the time, you can always, I mean, as we always, you know, spoke. So 5-why's, you dig deeper into 5-why's and figure out what is the root cause. And then you take some corrective measure, you know, to be able to, you know, fix that problem. So, and this is actually much simpler. I mean, it's being used in software. I'll show you. Ultimately, this makes that, you know, you should eliminate the defect right there at, you know, at the source where it is happening, and try and, you know, build some more, you know, smart mechanism so that it doesn't happen. So, for example, at Toyota, if they figure out that, you know, actually net nuts are the problem. After 5-why's and figure out, you know, some specific net is not working and that is cracking too often, so there could be quality issues. So they, you know, they make sure that they send out a team to check the quality at their partner and figure out, you know, why is something is going wrong, you know, till that level, and then, you know, in the meantime have it you know, replaced on a scheduled interval. A simple example, Google. You're searching for keywords, you're not getting result. You know, Google, you know, team has, you know, analyzed that, you know, people are not getting it because they are typing something wrong. There is, you know, so the autofill mechanism can come in, right? So it could be as simple as that. It could be even more difficult. I'm going to show you I was recently, you know, reading an article on how Amazon does lean, and some of these, it was very interesting. So Amazon has almost they've been doing it for 4 years. So they monitor the video, you know, if you pay for a video for you know, some of the video watching services. And if the video, they monitor how it is getting streamed. If it is too slow and you encountered a problem, you've paid for the video, you don't have to reach a customer support. They will monitor it automatically and they'll give you a refund. So some of the customers were like, wow, I mean, you know, I know, you know, 2 days back I was watching a video, it was too slow, but I didn't realize they'll get a refund email automatically, you know, saying that, you know, you had experienced some difficulties, here is, you know, your money back. So that was an amazing example. So a couple of other, you know, so I'll share this article. It has a whole bunch of other articles that, you know, examples where Amazon is doing lean in various, you know, error mechanism, you know, to put in place. Another example was for a stop the line, you know, the Andon card. So they're using Andon card in terms that their customer service team, if you report a problem to Amazon that this product, but, you know, particular product that you bought is not right. There's some issue in that. So the service agent has the authority at that level, you know, just a customer support agent, that if he has found the problem, you know, twice or thrice, he can pull off that whole product from the site, you know. So, and then, you know, he'll initiate the channels where someone will go and actually analyze the root cause, talk to the vendor, why is this happening, so that you know the quality is taken care right at the source. So some of these things, if you apply without you know much of an effort, it could sort of drastically improve the way you know we are working or building software. I'll quickly introduce one more guy. I mean, so I'm just giving a little bit you know glimpse and you know sort of perspective of the history so that you know you guys know when you talk about lean, you know exactly how you know the lean has come up. So he's also pretty important guy. So Taichi Ono was working actually passed out from a college and directly recruited at Toyota you know weaving Toyota looms. He worked there and he saw how Jidoka and on some of these things are applied. And then later he was transferred to the car manufacturing division at Toyota. So he undertook a lot of you know improvements. I don't know whether you know. So when Toyota started with cars, they were actually they didn't have any technology. So they took body four chassis. They took Benz you know body, put it together, tried to make some cars, and also tried to copy initially you know put some of these because there was no demand in Japan. So they can't price it too much, and if you can't have a demand, you can't mass produce. So they were trying to figure out whole bunch of ways how they can reduce cost. So that is at the core of you know how they became successful because you know they can't have 10,000 cars because they don't have a demand, and if they go that way, they can't reduce the cost. So they implemented some of these mechanisms you know by which they can improve and bring down the cost and at the same time you know produce good quality cars. There's another guy you know called Deming. I mean probably you've heard Deming. So Deming was a you know U.S. You know economist. He was not as much known in the U.S., but the moment you know, so as a part of delegation after World War II, he was sent to Japan to you know sort of rebuild, help Japan rebuild the economy, and there he got very popular. So some of these you know practices that you know, root cause analysis and what you see, a lot of control you know, charts and statistical analysis, he taught them you know to them, and they almost like took him as guru and you know took all the inputs. Okay, so. That's where the next thing comes. So now, I mean, if you look at the history, so Japan had very less of a demand. Obviously, they can't mass produce. So they found out that, you know, what if we produce just to the customer demand, you know, because that will keep our inventory costs low. So that is where just-in-time was, you know, introduced. So, you know, and it happened like, you know, in a bunch of series of experiments that they ran, and you know, they figured out, you know, let's just, you know, move this part and, you know, see if we can quickly put together something rather than waiting. So, because inventory is a huge cost, they don't have money to, you know, take you know 5,000 nuts and you know all the spare parts and keep it. So they came up with more innovative you know ways to do it. So, do you guys know just in time? I mean, it's a pretty known concept. Anyone who doesn't know, I'm going to skip the basic. So, have you guys seen any examples in software? Yeah, but they are actually more visual. I mean, I've just put it because it's a Domino's does it. I mean, by the time you actually order a pizza, you can track it where exactly it is, and you know it gets served to you. Any software example? You guys know any software example? You go to. In fact, so some, how it can be applied in software is, I mean, we carry a lot of waste or debt, you know, in terms of processes. A lot of time we end up building, doing a very heavy design, even though when you know we don't need that software immediately, we end up doing a lot of requirement gathering, you know, even though things could change pretty rapidly, you know, we could build more and more, you know, test cases, even though the feature is going to come up much later. So if you eliminate some of those, you know, you can easily reach a stage where if a customer is asking for a feature, and you take it through your you know value stream and put it up. One more delivered. I have two more. So in case you get bored, I'll change it. So I mean, one of the things that I'm going to talk about is if someone mentioned that you've implemented Scrumban. So Scrumban is also you know one of the great ways to do you know, JIT you know in some way. Right. So when Toyota started you know just in time, it was not that easy because you know you can't put everything you know there are always delays between the process and it's very hard to figure out you know especially if you have you know 50 different parts going on. So how do you you know try and you know, do that? So one of the things they said is, you know, obviously they came up with a list of, you know, waste that they produce in the system. There are a lot of unevenness in the process. So for example, you know, if you have you know, if you're producing 10-step process and your fourth step is only, you know, it takes much longer time, it has only one guy, obviously you will not be able to, you know, make it flow. So you will create unevenness in the system. So you have to look out for those and you know, then try and solve those. And then so some of the concept here which they also applied was theory of constraint. So that also can be applied. Have you guys read The Goal? Anyone? So some of the, you know, that concept also can be applied. So I mean, basically it's a theory of constraint which says that you have to, you know, you don't have to look for local, you know, optimization, because local optimization will lead to, you know, sub optimization at the, you know, overall level. So you try and, you know, for example, in a simple term, if you try and solve one bottleneck, somewhere else the bottleneck will come up. So you have to systematically, you know, fix that problem, and so that your overall flow is much smoother. So you don't look at, you know, just improving coding, you know, for example. I mean, by putting more and more developers. Putting more developers is not going to help, because, you know, next guy, which are testers, they may not be there. You know, or example, you know, there's no one in the build to build it. So you have to look at the overall value stream and then fix, you know, some of these problems and optimize. Just a quick comparison of what are the different waste that they have. So they have a waste in terms of inventory, motion, waiting. Overproduction. Overproduction is a big waste in manufacturing. Overprocessing, defects, you know, obviously are there. You know, even just the transportation. So if you have, you know, warehouses much far off, you're going to spend a lot of time in just, you know, getting stuff from, you know, one warehouse to other, and, you know, stuff like that. We have the same thing in software. So in terms of, you know, partially done work, you get one feature, suddenly, you know, you jump on and start building something else, and that feature is somewhere hanging. You know, it's just lying there. You have a lot of process overheads. I mean, at least some of the bigger options, I mean, do you guys have this problem? I at least know of some of this, you know, even new guy onboarding a laptop will take 2 weeks to come from the IT ops, right? So you've lost almost 2 weeks of you know, productivity. A lot of extra features. So if you guys attended Running Lean talk in the morning, features that nobody wants, you know, there's no point in building. So obviously, I mean, you have to build to the customer demand. So if you build it that way, you have much you know, better you know, software and no feature debt. I think I'm just, you know, quickly. So one of the ways to find waste, you know, one of the ways to find waste is to put your entire value stream in picture. You know, if you're able to, you know, write from where the customer, you know, request is coming to, and from where are you delivering the value. If you put this entire thing together in one place and try and visualize, you'll start seeing where can you improve. So for example, you know, if this is your entire process, you will see that between each of these steps, you have a lot of wait time. If you're just able to somehow reduce that itself, you will have much faster time to market. Right? So that is one of the ways that you know, Toyota solved the problem. I'm going to skip one or two. And the next is Kanban. So Kanban was also developed because, you know, ultimately to reduce the inventory and also make the whole just-in-time flow much better. Are you guys aware of Kanban? Anyone? You want me to elaborate a bit? So it goes along with the, I'll take an example. So, you know, I mean, if you're just able to visualize your entire value stream and implement pull in the system. So as of now, you're trying and assigning features to your developers, and then that guy is working and handing off to someone else. In between, there's a lot of weight that you're, you know, developing, as I was showing an example. So by implementing, you know, Kanban and putting, you know, restricting a number of features that you can work in, you know, sort of putting how many things you can work, you know, at one point of time, that will build constraint in the system, which will be visible, and then you can, you know, tackle where, you know, you want to optimize, you know, the overall flow. And the last one, Kaizen. So that's a big culture at Toyota, you know, which lets them, you know, find continuously ways to improve their overall value stream. You know, they find out, you know, each and everything where they can try and improve, you know, the overall process and, you know, optimize the flow. I'm just going to give a quick perspective. There's a whole bunch of things to learn at Toyota. I've just touched, you know, probably 10, 11 odd, you know, techniques. You know, there are things like, you know, 5 Whys, there are PDCA. All of those can be, you can always learn, read more about it, and try and implement it. All of these can be easily implemented in software and, you know, obviously help you get value. Quick recap. So, I mean, you know, you can always build quality at the source, you know, try and automate more in software, use visual signals to highlight problems, because that will get you the attention very fast and help you resolve things. Try and mistake proof the system, try and find out whatever errors or mistakes are coming up, if you can build mechanism to fix it right at the source. Get to the root cause using 5 whys. Go and see it at the workplace and resolve the problem. Just in time, continuous flow. Try and eliminate waste you're in in that system, and try and reduce evenness, overloading, and enable pull in the system, and keep learning. That's actually not in Japanese. Thank you. There are a bunch of books that I'll share the deck and you can refer. Any questions? Any specific questions on any specific technique?
Manufacturing industry, why do you think in the software industry we should be learning lean when it is actually not coming from a software industry but instead a hardware industry?
That was my I was trying to demonstrate some of these techniques that you saw, how they can be applied. I mean, did you feel some of these things can be applied in software? Because so ultimately, I'll go back to the first diagram. I mean, do we have problems in software that we are not able to solve?
Yes, but ultimately, the industries are completely different.
But so it is also because they are implementing quality right at the source, which is not leading to. Otherwise, we also, you guys see our Tata Nano burning to fires. Yeah.
So there have been multiple recalls.
Multiple recalls. So there are bugs right there.
That there should not be bugs because it will kill people. But
in software, if there's a
bug, will it not kill people?
The perspective is different, but I think in 90% of software cases, it is not that big. That's why bugs probably, I think, won't matter as much as in the hardware industry.
So there are quality of bugs, but that does not stop us to look around for solutions, if you look at why are we looking, because we have a problem, we are not able to control bugs no matter what process you go, you move from
waterfall to iterative to others, because probably we have just built processes which were not optimal as much, as optimal. If you're looking around, for agile, so why are you going agile? Because you could learn what you're building for the customer, collaborate with them, and don't build something which they don't want, right? And if you try and draw analogy, both have a series of steps. Ultimately, both have a series of steps where you go through, right? I mean, if you I could go back to the example. Ultimately, be it a manufacturing or software, you have a series of steps that you perform. You have a whole value stream. We also have a value stream, right? And that is what it is going through. So there is a lot of similarity. I mean, in terms of end product, it could be different, but there is a lot of similarity between both.
Right, it is actually
up from some of the lean things.
Yeah. Okay. Outline some of these concepts, particularly like Scrumban. So you limit WI, means work in progress.
Right.
So sometimes you discover that maybe you have more number of developers than less number of testers, and because of that, the stories are building.
Right.
But there are not enough testers, so there is a wait time. So that is a waste. Now, if you want to reduce that waste, then you'll have to convert either some developers into testers.
Right.
And then you can have a flow.
Right.
So I think that reduces overall lead time for delivering each of the user story or defect fields. That we have really seen it.
Absolutely. I mean, see, that's where it is coming. So ultimately, if you look at
software and manufacturing, what are we trying to do? We are trying to deliver a value to the customer. That is at the end. I mean, our products are different. The way you build, could be, here and there. Obviously, the type of product could be different. But ultimately, you're trying to deliver value. And we are trying to see how you can deliver value better and faster. you had any question?
So depending on the context,
I mean, a lot of times, I mean, actually you don't, you probably may not go till the fifth why. You'll probably get your answer, which the whole team is satisfied with and say, you know what, yeah, I think this is what it is, right? So then you don't need to go, you know, even beyond probably third why. But in case you know, the team is still not coming up to a conclusion, you know, then there could be some deeper problem. You may not even get it in the first go. You may suspect something, work out a solution, and probably you will figure out that there is something, you know, some problem, something else, you know, might come up.
Right.
So some of the things, you know, I mean.
I think that itself is told that the problem is a circle, so it's it just gives a problem. 5 is typically an optimal number for the depth.
You can have many nodes. I mean, I forgot to show you.
Examples, I mean, you can even use fishbone analysis, you know, which is also very popular, where you have y's at each of these levels. You know, you could have one y, and that is leading to two root causes, and that could go in its own chain, and this could go in its own chain, and then you could figure out, probably you have uncovered little more than one problem, you know, in, you know, that you can fix. I mean, anything you want to add, Doc? I mean, since you guys, right, did I answer? Yeah. Anything else that, you know? Right.
Happened in software industry.
Right. I was just giving you
all the software examples, right? I mean, you know.
Those things into software or something we're matching or some context, something matching with our industry we are moving in here, right? But we are trying or applying those things which is success in a different domain or different industry, we are trying it out here.
Right.
Like, is there anything like brand new or creative things that happened in software industry itself? Like, we tried out something from our problems itself. Just curious to know, is there anything? Anybody?
From software, we are trying Scrum XP. You know, that is what we have come up with, right? Which is not, yeah, which is not, you know, in some context not leading to, you know, it is a lot of, you know, so if you also see that, you know, XP also we are talking about, you know, continuous integration. Conceptually, it can even be mapped to Zidoka, which is what they did, you know, 6 years back. Anything else? All right, thank you. Thank you very much. We'll move on to the keynote, which is right there. Right on the same conference schedule, where, you know, you're seeing each of the, there's already placeholder for slides, so we're gonna go and upload there. Right. Yeah, so we'll go back, you know, I think end of the conference, you know, so you'll have it tomorrow. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.